Om Shanti. Today Baba says that this human birth and this time is most valuable or invaluable. And I will tell you that once I was listening to one katha in bhakti, and it was on the occasion of somebody leaving their body and the katha they do at that time. And in that, they were saying, the Panditji was saying that, so, you know, according to bhakti, it is said that we take birth in 84 lakh species and you become a dog and a cat and a mouse and a pigeon and whatnot. And then ultimately you become a human. And that was the katha going on. And they said that, think about you moving around in a maze. So there are lots of, you know, there are lots of paths in that maze. And they said that in those paths, you change many forms. So you take many births. You take a birth as a dog and a cat and a mouse and everything. And then there is one opening in that maze through which you can go out. And that opening is when you get a human birth. And in that human birth, you can go out. That is, you can get mukti if you want. So you cannot get mukti in any of the other births, but you can get mukti in this. And Baba says that these are funny stories in bhakti. And you know, then in that same katha, that Panditji later on said that in the manushyoni, as a human, this is the only birth where you can have a hedonistic life, which is you can eat, drink and be merry. So you should enjoy it also. So then there was this thing about mukti also, and then there was this thing about hedonistic approach to life also. And it was all jumbled up. And today Baba tells us the truth about this story from bhakti. And Baba has told us that human souls only take human bodies. So a human soul doesn't become a cat or a dog or a mouse. It takes a human body. And Baba also gives us the logic that just like a mango seed will also always become a mango. You know, it's not like this time it becomes a mango and the next time you put it in the, you know, you bury it in the earth, it surprises you by becoming an apple. It doesn't happen like that. So you know that it's a mango seed. Every time it goes and into the ground, it becomes a mango. So Baba says that a human soul will always take a human body, a human birth. And I remember there was this, so I was with the health ministry and I was once going once in a place, and there was this girl who came up to me and she was working with the World Health Organization. And she said, "Are you a Brahma Kumari?" I said, "Yes." So she said, "You are the only people who say that humans incarnate as humans." So I said, "Yes." So she said, "Yes, our research also proves that. So I'm happy to meet you because research says that." So all this past life regression and everything these days, they point out and say that a human soul wouldn't take a human other than a human body. So that was corroborated in that meeting also. Now Baba says that a human soul doesn't take any other body other than a human body, and you keep taking human bodies one after the other. And Baba has told us that the minimum number of births that we take is one, not zero. So there is no concept of mukti. You cannot be in a state where you just keep you know, staying in the soul world and never come down, that doesn't happen. So the minimum number of births that a human soul takes is one, and the maximum is 84. So according to the karma we do or the drama that's fixed, we either take 84 births or one birth or somewhere in between. So somebody takes 83, somebody takes 82, something, some number between 1 and 84. And then Baba Tudu says that once you come down, you are in that maze. So Baba has told us that you cannot, you don't have a choice. So, you know, once you come down from this soul world, you keep coming down. So when once you come down, even Satyug, you don't have the option to go to a place better than Satyug. So, you know, you always keep coming down from Satyug to come down to Treta Yug, to Dwapar Yug, to Kal Yug. So you get worse and worse. So you lose your fortune gradually. That's the law. So I am relating it to that bhakti story where they say you are in the circle and you can't go out. So, you know, you are really in a circle once you come down, and it's not like you are in a circle where you keep changing it from one species to the other. You will continue to be a human, but you will continue to lose your fortune gradually because it is a phase of descent, and you cannot ascend your stage. That's how it goes. But then this time comes, and this is, and you know, they say that the human birth is very valuable, but Baba says you always take human births, but this confluence aged birth is very valuable. So then finally, taking birth after birth after birth, you arrive at this time where God comes, Shiv Baba comes. And when Shiv Baba comes, he teaches you the skills and gives you the knowledge to do something which you didn't have an option to do before. And what is that? So Baba today says that if you really do as Shiv Baba says, you will move from a life of bondage to a life of freedom. Okay, so Baba says there is life in Satyug also, there is life in Kaliyug also, and both lives are human lives, but the life in Satyug, the life of a human in Satyug, is without bondage, no karam bandhan. And in from the copper age onwards, there is the bondage of vikarma or the bondage of vices. And Baba says, this time you have a choice. If you take the choice, you move to a world free from bondage. And bondage of death, bondage of sorrow, bondage of desire. Yes, so you move to a world where there is no bondage, there is Jivan Mukti. And if you don't take this opportunity, then you again come to a world where there is bondage. So this is your only chance to take the choice to move from a world of bondage to a world free from bondage. And if you don't take this choice now, then birth we will definitely have, but then we will come later and we will come to a world where there is bondage of desire, bondage of sorrow, bondage of death. Yes, so Baba says that this is the real meaning of that story in bhakti that you read. And Baba says that, do you recognize the importance of this time? So it's not like the Panditji said in the Katha that Now you have a human birth, so eat, drink, and be merry and enjoy the fruits of having a human birth. So Baba says, you have a body, you have a mind, you have a buddhi, you have the gyan with which you can do the karma and make the choice of moving from a life of bondage to a life of freedom. That is why this body, this time, this birth is very precious. And Baba today says that you should use every breath of this life to remember Baba. And in Hindi it is said, swaso swas yaad karo. Shwaso shwas, which means just like you see that there is no break in breathing. You take one breath after the other. Similarly, remembrance should of Baba should be so continuous. And when you do that, then Baba will give you the power, the sense, the sensibility to do karma, which will make you move from this life of bondage to a life of freedom. Do you realize that we are in bondage now? So you want to be happy, you can't be. You want to be peaceful, you can't be. And there are desires, and then, so you know, I've seen people who want to get married, and then when they get married, they are not happy with who they got married to. They want children, and then they get children, and then they are not happy with the children they had. And so you see, it's such a bondage. So when your desires are fulfilled, it is a problem. When your desires are not fulfilled, it is a problem. Everything is a problem. So you know, somebody told me the other day that unfulfilled desires are the problem. I said, no, I don't think so. I have met many people whose desires were fulfilled, and that was the bigger problem. So so you see, we don't know. So it everything is bondage. You think that this is the way out, and when you take that way, you end up in greater trouble. So we are living at a time when solutions are the doorway to newer problems. And this is what a life of bondage looks like. So, you know, people are scared of the virus and people are scared of the vaccine. So this is the predicament we are facing. And then, so we are living in such a time. And Baba says, you want to move to a world where there's absolute happiness, absolute peace, relationships which are loving, and there is health that supports you always, ever healthy bodies, ever peaceful minds, then you take this opportunity. Don't waste this time. And Baba says, and you know what? People in the world have a perception that this time is the worst time of all. So, you know, people think that we are living in the worst of times. And here Baba is saying us that we are living in the most valuable of times. Yes, and then there was this one person who said that, what is the point of life these days? So, you know, what is the point in anything? So there is no point in getting up. There is no point in working. There is no point in breathing. There is no point in having relationships because they fail you any moment. And then I said, the point is you are a point. And the point is, you become a point now. So this is not a time to find a point in other things. This is a time where the point is that you become a point by remembering the point. So, you know, we have always thought that the point is in getting in being loved, in being cared of, in being, you know, in being wealthy and in being healthy. But the point of this time is not getting or doing something outside. The point is to remember the point and become the point. And this is the best time to do that. And this is the only time when we have the knowledge and the power to do that. And Baba says, and do you know that a point is the interface between everything and nothing? So a point is, you know, a point is somewhere between existence and non-existence. So, you know, that which is physical and that which is non-physical, the interface between that is the point. And when you become a point, you can transition from the physical to the non-physical. So Baba says that use every second of this time, which people think this is a very difficult time or there is no point in this time. You use this time, every second of this time, to remember Baba and become a point. To remember Baba and become like Baba. Don't even waste 1 second. And Baba today says that there is no need for any chanting in this. So Baba says it is about reminding yourself of your original religion, your original form, original home, original parent. So Baba says it is just about maintaining that continuous awareness of the truth. So you don't even have to chant something or repeat something. It's this time to make the most of this time. You just have to maintain the awareness of who you really are, what your home is, or where you've come from, and who your parent is. And when you keep holding on to this awareness, then you make the most of this Sangam Yuga. So this is what Baba says. And I would like you to ask yourself today whether you are really using this opportunity of the Sangam Yuga well. Because just like I told you about that story in Bhakti, they say that there is only one opening in that whole circle. And if you don't take that opening, then you keep coming back. So Baba says there is only one opportunity to move from bondage to freedom. Otherwise, again, we will come back to a world where there is sorrow, where there is bondage. So if we want to take this opportunity, we can. If we miss this opportunity, we again come back to a time where there is sorrow and death and misery. So we have to be sensible and take this opportunity. And Baba today says that, Baba uses a very interesting word. Baba says, you should have unlimited buddhi or brains so that you can use this time to A, remember Baba, and B, do seva. So let me read out what Baba says. Baba says, the brains of you children should be very unlimited for service. Remember the father and gain victory over Ravan. Don't waste your breath. Those who waste their time are said to be senseless. The father would say to them, you are not doing the service to make someone's life as valuable as a diamond. There is so much waste of time and waste of energy. You don't understand anything, and this is why you are called those with stone intellects. So do you understand that you have the knowledge and you know the art of remembering Baba, and you have the capacity to teach someone how to realize the value of their life. Yes, but if you don't do that seva and waste your time, then Baba says, I would say that you have a stone intellect, a buddhi that doesn't realize anything. So Baba says, those who understand the importance of the time and their life and what they have got, those Brahmins never waste their time and energy. Yes. And you know, there was this brother and he worked with a big company, and they were into some infrastructure, I think. And he used to take many tours over many cities, and he used to listen to Gyans, you know, he had just taken the course. And then one day he said that, I feel very sad when I visit many cities and see the condition of people there. So I visit small towns and villages, and I see that they are in such pathetic state. And every time I come back from the tour, I feel very sorrowful and sorry. So I said, but you should be very happy. So I said, why? Why should I be happy when other people are sorrowful? So I said, because when other people are sorrowful, you have the opportunity to make them happy. And this is a very important thing to understand. And Baba says that there is so much of sorrow, so much of misery around. And do you know why there is so much sorrow and so much misery? Because of only one reason, lack of knowledge. People don't have knowledge that they are beyond life and death. They are a soul and their parent is God. And Baba today also says that Baba feels mercy for his children, that they should know their father. And you see that every soul is a child of God. And God is giving them the inheritance or the legacy of fearlessness, of courage, of peace, of purity, of love, powers. But they don't know their father, and so they don't have all of this. So Baba says, you have the opportunity, you have the knowledge to give that to them. And if you waste your time and don't do this seva, then Baba would say that you have a stone intellect. And Baba would say that you don't have the sense to not waste your time. And you know, people say these days that they don't have time, but this is the time when majority people waste most of their time. And if you look at the internet consumption, or how much they are on the screen, or how much they watch content, and how much they watch rumors and other stuff. So you will realize that people are wasting time to the tune of almost 3/4 of their day. It is not an exaggeration, it is the truth. And Baba says that those people don't understand that this is such a valuable time which has to be used to remember Baba and come back to your own power, and also it has to be used to earn a spiritual income by telling every soul, giving them their introduction and their father's introduction. But Baba says, you waste your time when you don't have unlimited buddhi. Unlimited buddhi means you don't think big. So when you limit yourself to, I finished my work and I have enough money and I don't need to do anything, and you don't think about what is the call of time, the genuine spiritual call of time, then you end up wasting your time. So this is what Baba says. And then today, Baba says, there is a so you know there is Baba says that there are so many stories in the world, and those stories have their origin here in Sangam Yoga. And there are many stories Baba talks about today, but there is this story of Gul Bakawali that Baba talks about, and I will tell that story because most people don't know this story. So, you know, Baba mentions the story of Aladdin and Hatim Tai and all, which we know somewhat. But this story of Gul Bakawali, so I'm not very sure about the story, but whatever I know, I'll share with you. So, it is said in the story that there was this queen, and she used to invite people for a game of chess. And when they used to come, and she used to play chess with them, and when she used to defeat them, she would put them into trouble. So that was the system of the queen. And she would always win. How? She had a trick. So what she used to do is, she used to keep the lamp on a cat. So the lamp that lit the place where the chess was played was placed on a cat. And as soon as she was about to lose, she would release some mice. And then the cat would run after the mice, and the lamp would get toppled over. And then there was darkness, and she would turn the game around in the darkness. So this is how she always won. So Baba says Maya also does this. So Baba calls Maya cat. Baba says always in the Murli, Baba says Maya Billi. So Baba says as soon as you are going to win, what Maya does is Maya changes the game by running around, and so Maya is like the cat which plays a part in diffusing the lamp. So it makes you body conscious, it takes you away from soul consciousness, and then you make the mistakes. So Baba says that is the story of Gul Bakawali. And then Baba says there's the story of Hatim Tai, where Hatim Tai had this magic, it was called Moolhara. And Hatim Tai had been given that Moolhara, and Hatim Tai was on this conquest, and he had to win many, cross many gates and win many things. And then whenever he was confronted with a challenge or an obstacle, he just had to eat that Moolhara, and then that challenge would go away. So Baba says, what is that Moolhara that I give you? That is the remembrance of Baba. So you are on your journey to Satyug, and whenever you face a challenge, if you remember Baba, that challenge will become smaller and you will come back to your power, and then you will be able to cross the challenge. So Baba says, people think that all those stories are related to limited acquisitions. So it is about a limited game of chess, or it is about Hatim Tai's conquest for a limited kingdom. But Baba says, actually, these stories are about the unlimited journey of the soul and the unlimited kingdom of Satyug. And the challenges are also about the unlimited challenges that the soul faces because of its sanskars. So Baba says, people don't understand the symbolism, but all the stories are related to this period of confluence age. So this is something that Baba says. And then Baba says I'll read out the slogan first, and then if time is left, we'll understand some more points. No, the blessing we'll read today first. So the blessing today is, may you be an elevated effort maker who has renounced all desires for any reward and who makes good effort. So let me tell you one thing. There is a very funny story. there's this brother, he's a Kumar. And when he came to the center, he said, Didi, I sit on the study table all day and I don't study anything. He's a student and he told me, I sit on the study table all day and I don't study anything. So I said, what do? You use the phone. He said, no, I have switched off the phone. No phone. Then he said, what do? So he said, I always keep thinking about what I will become when I get good marks in the exam. So, you know, I think about the college, I think about job, I think about all the stuff, but I just don't study. So I said, but how will you get there if you just don't study and keep thinking about that? He said, that's why I've come here. I have this strange problem. Every time I begin to study, I start creating these castles in the air where I think about how I'll get this score and that score, and then so many people will call me and there'll be interviews and then I'll get a job. And then I'm so tired after all of that, I just close the book and sleep. So Baba also today says something like that. So, you know, there are two things. There is karma and then there is attainment of the karma. Yes. But if you keep thinking about the attainment and don't do any karma, then how will you get the attainment? So when you have desires, what happens is, instead of doing what you need to do for the desire, you start thinking about the desire. Yes, so that's what happens. And Baba today says, an elevated effort maker is one who doesn't have a desire to experience any reward for his efforts. Where there are desires, cleanliness finishes, and you become one who is constantly thinking. Those who wish to experience their rewards here deprive themselves of accumulating their future incomes. Therefore, instead of the word desire, remember the word good. Ichha bolke achha yaad rakho. Okay? Don't remember the word desire. Remember the word good, achha. An elevated effort maker is constantly making effort to become flawless. He or she never fails at anything. So let's understand what Baba is trying to say. Baba says that the motivation for your action should not be the reward for your effort. So the motivation for your action should be that through your action, you want to become flawless. So you don't want perfect reward. You want to become without defects through your actions. And the thing is, you know, whenever you do something and there is a result that follows from it, the journey from action to result is not smooth. Yes, there is there are lots of challenges that come in the way. And your intention will define your journey. So if I have embarked on a journey with the intention to get the reward, then whenever there is a challenge, I will get very upset because that challenge is coming between me and the attainment of my reward. So I will feel jealous, I will feel angry, I will feel hopeless. I will feel fear, I will get upset. And then what happens is, maybe you sometimes will get the reward according to drama, but even if you get the physical reward, your You will lose spiritually in the process. Yes, so your spiritual income will deplete even if your physical income increases. This is why Baba says, never do anything with desire for the reward for it. Baba says, whenever you do something, your aim should be that through this action, through this journey, you want to be flawless. And you want to work on every defect. So whenever there is a challenge, again, you know, challenges will come on the journey. And when those challenges come, instead of seeing the challenges as a challenge that has come between you and your reward, you see it as a challenge that has come between you and your perfect stage. And then you take care of your stage while dealing with that challenge. And then you, and when you do good karma, you will get the reward externally also, and your spiritual income also will increase. Yes? And I'm telling this from personal experiences. So, you know, even in godly seva, there are many challenges. And because we do godly seva on Srimat, and Baba gives us the wisdom to do these things. So whenever there is a challenge, we don't feel afraid because this seva is just a means to, you know, to practicing our skills and our virtues. So even if we understand that nobody is coming, or, you know, you printed 10,000 leaflets and there is no response, or, you know, there is nobody is responding, you always feel that you are doing it so that you make your stage better. So you focus on that. And then the nature of a challenge is it comes, it persists for a while, and it goes away. But if you understand that in the face of a challenge, what is most important is that you attempt to be flawless within. You attempt to discern your defects and remove them, then even in the face of that challenge coming, persisting and leaving, you have enhanced your stage. So that challenge has given you a gift of an experience or a realization. So the fruit has come a little later, that external fruit, but even in that times which you thought was a challenge, you received a gift. So this is something. And then the slogan is, use the facilities as a lotus flower because they are the fruit of your karma yoga. So you see that when you do good karma, when you do karma yoga, which is you do karma in the remembrance of Baba, it's not that you don't get something. You get more than you get when you do karma yoga. When you do karma without remembering Baba, you receive fruits. But when you do karma yoga, you receive greater fruits. Yes? But then, that's there also Maya can trick you. So sometimes you do the karma in remembrance of Baba, and when the fruit comes, you get caught up in the fruit. Yes, so sometimes, you know, it's a very interesting thing that you do something in remembrance of Baba because at that time you have paid attention that I'm not doing it for the fruit. But when the fruit comes, it's so enchanting that you get caught up in the fruit. Yes, so Baba says that when you have done karma yoga, which is your karma is done in the remembrance of God and you get a fruit, then use the fruit also like a lotus flower, which is use it again, you know, in a detached manner. Don't get attached to it. Don't develop greed for it. Use it in an altruistic way so that it multiplies. Otherwise, this cycle of karma yoga and fruit will end then and there. But if you just perpetuate this cycle, then you will multiply it. So when you use the fruit or like a lotus flower, then you will multiply it. And if you get attached to the fruit, then probably you will kill the cycle there and there'll be no more benefit going ahead. Yes, so you did something good, you get the benefit. But if you use the benefit for greater good, then greater good will follow. So this is something that Baba teaches us. So, and it's a very good idea to always be an instrument and be the catalyst for growth. Yes, so when you are a catalyst, you facilitate things, and then you use the facilities that come from the results in like a lotus flower, and they multiply and they give rise to more facilities. So Baba asks us to be a catalyst in between. Okay, Om Shanti.